I welcome you to Mount Calvary's service of Matins for the fourth Sunday of Advent. Do not let appearances deceive you. We are still in the Advent season of waiting for the arrival of our Lord, and so we rejoice in his coming and all the promise. For those of you joining us online, if you'd like to get a copy of the bulletin for this morning's service, go to our webpage, www.mountcalvarypeoria.org. Look under Media, and you'll see where you can download a copy. For the rest of you all, if you take time to fill out one of the registration cards, drop it off in the offering plate when you depart. We appreciate your help with that. And now, everyone take a moment and wave at one another. You are all at peace with each other as we enter this service. With that said, we go to our opening hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, 338. I invite you to stand for the order of confession. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. I invite you to examine your conscience now in silence before the Lord, according to his word, in your place in life. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father, most merciful God.
We confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
O Lord, open my lips,
and my mouth will lift the praise.
Make haste, O God, to deliver me.
Make haste to help me, O Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Praise to you, O Christ, King who comes to save us. Behold, the Lord comes to save us. O come, let us worship him. Behold, the Lord comes to save us. You may be seated. We join together in the responsive singing of the psalm. O Emmanuel, our King and our Lord, the anointed of the nations and their Savior. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. With my mouth I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. You have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant.
I will establish your offspring forever, and build your throne for all generations.
Let the heavens praise your wonders, O Lord. Your faithfulness in the assembly of the holy ones. I have found David, my servant. With my holy oil I have anointed him.
So that my hand shall be established with him, my arm also shall strengthen him.
The enemy shall not outwit him, the wicked shall not humble him. My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. He shall cry to me, You are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation.
And I will make him a firstborn, and I will honor him above all the kings of the earth.
My steadfast love I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. O Emmanuel, our King and our Lord, the Anointed for the nations and their Savior, the office hymn is 354, Arise, O Christian People. Continue with the lighting of our final candle. Drop down, you heavens from above, and let the skies pour down righteousness. Behold, the name of the Lord comes from far. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God has shined. As we wait to celebrate Christmas, as the birth of Jesus revealed the greatest gift of God's love and made us members of the Lord's household, let us then remember the great love God has lavished upon us, and light this candle as a sign. Let us pray. Gracious Savior, in this time of waiting, pour out your redeeming love upon us, so that by faith we may have new birth and share in your life, your love, and your mercy. Let us prepare to greet you with repentant hearts and watchful eyes, anticipating the joy you have promised to all whom you redeem. We ask this in your blessed name. So for our young folk, we are jumping to 9 months before Jesus' birth in our gospel reading today. And 9 months before Jesus was born, the angel Gabriel went to Mary in the town of Nazareth and announced to her that God's plan was about to unfold and that she was going to be front and center for that unfolding. Now, the thing that you need to remember is that it had been 400 years since anyone had heard anything from God. Right? The promises that one day a Savior would come go all the way back to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, when after they sinned, God promised that one day there would be a seed from the woman who would crush the head of that serpent Satan, and then they unfolded throughout the whole of the Old Testament, all the way up to Malachi, who said that there would be a messenger sent one day to go ahead and prepare the way for the Messiah to come, and then nothing. Silence for 400 years. But as Gabriel tells Mary God's plan unfolding, he says a very interesting thing to her, and you're going to hear in our translation that it says, for nothing will be impossible with God. But it turns out that's not what it really said. The more exact translation is, for now, no word of God will be without power. No word of God will be without power. All those words that God had spoken were now going to become powerful because of the birth of this son to Mary. And God said, right, he's going to get the throne of his father David. There hadn't been a king in Israel for 400 years, but now that promise of a throne for David was going to have power because of the birth of this child. Right? The Holy One would be born from her who would bring righteousness to all people, great and small. For all of history, ever since Adam and Eve, no human had ever been able to be righteous. But now that promise of righteousness would have power because of the birth of this child. And other things would unfold, right? God had promised one day death would be swallowed up, and no human being had been able to get past death until the birth of this child who would overcome death once and for all, because no word without God, with God, would be without power. So as you listen to the sermons, you listen to Gabriel talking to Mary, remember all those words that are spoken are going to be with power because of the birth of this child, Jesus. And I know you all have heard it before, but his name in the Hebrew would be Yeshua, and that literally translates as God saves, because he's God come to save us. And that's why we rejoice for his birth now and always. So I'm going to get back to the rest of the service. First reading is from the book of 2 Samuel, the 7th chapter. Now, when the king lived in his house and the Lord had given him rest from all his surrounding enemies, the king said to Nathan the prophet, "See now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells in a tent." And Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that is in your heart, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan. Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, would you build me a house to dwell in? I've not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I've been moving about in a tent for my dwelling. In all places where I've moved with all the people of Israel, did I speak a word with any of the judges of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now, therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, that you should be a prince over my people Israel. And I've been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they may dwell in their own place and be disturbed no more. And violent men shall afflict them no more as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house, and your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. Here ends the reading. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 16th chapter. Now, to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed and through the prophetic writings has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God to bring about the obedience of faith, to the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. Here ends the reading. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand for the gospel verse. Alleluia. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, as recorded in the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was greatly troubled at this saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary said to the angel, how will this be, since I'm a virgin? And the angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will dwell securely. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. You may be seated for the hymn. And so I bid you all grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. My brothers and sisters in Christ, for nothing will be impossible with God. And here we are, against all common sense, taking one more shot at Advent with Christmas leave literally at the door. And there's a reason for that. It's because you and I, we still need to prepare. Now, I'm pretty sure that for nearly all of us gathered here this morning, preparations are largely being thought of in terms of cooking, cleaning, and those last-minute details that need attention before all the hubbub starts. But spiritually speaking, the long tradition of the church thinks there's still some more preparation to do in terms of our faith. That is, in order to grasp the true wonder and joy of what came to pass at Bethlehem some 2,000 years ago, we need to grasp a little bit more about who was born and what that means, which is why we hear of Gabriel's visit to Mary this morning. Now, let me set the stage before we address our gospel directly. So, three things. First, in religion classes over at Concordia this month, the young folks have been finishing up their survey of the Old Testament and beginning to dip their toes into the new. And one thing that nearly all of the classes have done, all the grade levels in one way or another have done, is a lesson on the prophecies about the coming Messiah that were fulfilled with Jesus. It's good stuff. But here's the thing to consider about the circumstance of Israel the day that Gabriel was sent to Mary. As I said to the young people earlier, the prophets had been silent for 400 years. All those promises had been made. All those words had been spoken going all the way back to Adam and Eve. And then 400 years of silence, nothing, nada. It seemed as if things had just ground to a halt. Second, in our midweek services this year, as we looked at the readings from Isaiah from this year's Advent season, we took up the theme, Yahweh remembers his people. For it turns out that in the parlance of Scripture, when God remembers, he also acts to deliver. And just last week, we heard of the deliverer who would be sent with good news for the poor, good news that would bind up the broken, that would bring release to the captive, that would set at liberty those bound in prison. And finally, I got to speak on this very gospel reading in chapel this week and took the opportunity to point out that that phrase, nothing will be impossible with God, is not at all the same thing as saying anything is possible with God. This is not an invitation to engage in possibility thinking. God is not going to make up down. He's not going to make pigs fly, and he's not going to make ice hot. But what Gabriel does tell Mary is that with the birth of this child, this son, this Jesus, God's word will come to fruition. For what Gabriel said is not nothing will be impossible with God, but as I said to the folks earlier, it's no word will be without power with God. And that has a somewhat different sense to it. No word of God will be without power because the word is made flesh. That's the wonder of what Gabriel brought to Mary that day, that the word, God of God, light of light, would be born in time, in our humanity, bone of our bone, and that word, along with all the other words God had declared, would not be without power. Do not let appearances deceive. He may be born in a manger. The prophets may have been silent for a time, but from here on out, the power of the word would be made known to all. And just think of the other words that Gabriel spoke to Mary, that this child would have an everlasting kingdom on David's throne, that he would be holy, the Son of God, fulfilling all righteousness, that he would be called Jesus, Yeshua, which translates God saves. These words would all become true with power because God came down and in Mary's womb took our nature to himself. And think of the other words spoken by the prophets concerning the Savior over the centuries, that he would crush that ancient serpent's head, that in him death would be swallowed up forever. Now, to us, many of those words seem powerless. That is, they are beyond us to make true or real in any meaningful way. Humans have striven, for instance, to establish eternal kingdoms time and time again, but no matter their brilliance, no matter their power, no matter their extent, their resources, all of those kingdoms succumb to time and find themselves lost to the great dustbin of history. And we fallen men and women have often given into the temptation to try and establish our own righteousness before God, and all of you know how that's worked out, at least if we're honest, right? Rather than righteousness, we find in ourselves self-serving excuses, weakness, fear, envy, pride. We are anything but righteous and holy in of ourselves. And what about the devil, that old dragon? Well, despite countless folktales in which some clever hero manages to outwit Satan, the truth is quite the opposite. Ever since Eden, it has been clear that the devil's evil, his cunning, his strength are too much for us. We are his prey, and he delights to lead us into bondage and fear through our sin-broken nature. And then there's death. None of us has enough life to stand against death, for we are not God, and we have no power in ourselves. For us, our words and the words given to us if we do not have Christ are without power. It is impossible. We cannot save ourselves. And then Gabriel visited Mary and told her that she would conceive and bear a son, and that the power of the Most High would overshadow her, that God would be in this child born of her. And she, by the Spirit's leading, said, "Let it be with me according to your word. Let that word be powerful. Let it do what it says." And with that, the word was made flesh, and all of God's words rumbled with his power, and the long centuries of waiting came to an end. And the redemptive work of God was moved with power according to his word, and Jesus, the word made flesh, was powerful. And he gets the words of God done. Now, in Christ, God's word is with all its power, and an eternal kingdom is now established on this earth, and the gates of hell shall not stand against her. Don't let appearances fool you. Jesus has taken his seat on David's throne and now rules his people and all things in his church. Now, in Christ, God's word is with all of its power, and we fallen men and women are given Christ's perfect righteousness as our own to wear. Having put on Christ in the waters of holy baptism, we are now covered by him and live and move in him, even as his Spirit dwells in us. And so we are righteous before God, not with the tattered rags that we tried to take to ourselves, but with the perfect justice and holiness of Jesus, born of Mary, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now in Christ, God's word is with all of its power, and the devil has been vanquished. Like a chained, vicious animal, he can scowl, he can threaten and bark and growl all he wants, but he's chained and bound by the stronger one, even Jesus our Lord. The devil's lies are exposed in Christ's light. The devil's claim on us is ended because Christ has ransomed us with his innocent blood. Now, in Christ, God's word is with all of its power, and death is broken, with sin's death debt paid. With Christ having overcome the grave in our flesh, we in Christ know that death is swallowed up. Do not let appearances deceive you. The dead in Christ live because he lives, and God's word is not without power. There's but one thing to ask then. Why? Why has God wrought all of this? To what end does he take our flesh to fulfill his word with power? Simply so that in love he might be all in all and restore us to the inheritance we were created for. But that's what we'll address in a few hours. For now, rejoice, his word is powerful now and forevermore, and will accomplish that for which it is purposed. Even so, amen. And now may that peace that surpasses all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus until the glorious day of his appearing. Amen. I invite you to stand as we join together to sing the Te Deum.
Thank you.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come and help us by your might, that the sins which weigh us down may be quickly lifted by your grace and mercy. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Almighty God, Heavenly Father, your mercies are new to us every morning, and you abundantly provide for all our wants of body and soul. Give us, we humbly pray, your Holy Spirit, that we may heartily acknowledge your merciful goodness toward us, give thanks for all your benefits, and cheerfully serve you.
Amen.
Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, keep this nation under your care. Bless the leaders of our land, that we may be a people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to the other nations of the earth. Grant that we may choose trustworthy leaders, contribute to wise decisions for the general welfare, and serve you faithfully in our generation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And hear now the petitions we bring to you in our hearts. Speed recovery for Dale Brinkman, Carolyn Pauli, Kathy Lentz, Paula Horst, and Diane Freeman. Grant them all strength. Grant continued strength and recovery to Shirley King, Patty Coy, and Sue Elder. Watch over Kim and Gartley, Ilsa Adams, Bob Burden, Donna Kirkman, J.C. Greyer, Nora Rossman, Tricia Smith, Nan Barunda, Roger Woolsey, Jane Wood, and Sally Taylor. Continue to strengthen Virginia Tackman and Harriet Coy. Uphold Lori Livingston and grant her strength and good health. Bless and keep Jennifer Lentz. Give comfort and peace to Kathy and to Harold Paul. I give healing and strength to Ann Jacobson. Strengthen Marty Likes, Bill Barr, and Ada Becker. Grant health and healing to Hugh, Jessica Horman, Linda Perrone, PJ Camacho, Pam Barr, Earl Boyette, Mary Dowds. Give continued healing to Miguel Bulwark, Carol Hoffman, Carol Lockridge, Ms. Ritter, and Natalie Brusick. Give relief to Mark Manthe. Grant healing to Virginia, David, Shirley, and Deaconess Julian. Grant recovery to Mark. Grant health and strength to Harriet, Nora, Ann Bulwark, Chris, Patty, Jim, and Gary. Also watch over Ryan and Carol Stetzler, Bill Parrott, Sally Leon, Joanne Bettinghouse, TJ, Maureen and her children, Cheryl, Gloria, Sally, and Steve. Bless and keep Jenny Bradley, Theo Norman, Rebecca, Tamisha, Jenny, John, Constance, Linda, Kenneth, Lori, and grant them all wellness. Speed healing for Pam and Dolores. Bless the Tompkins family and Clara. Grant grace to Jackie and her family. Give relief to Kathy and Lil. Grant strength and healing to Josh, Bill, Bray, Lynn, and Gabby. Give health to Gordon and Jim. Be with all travelers to give them safe journeys. Also watch over Shirley, Max, Neil, Shane, Faith, Jenna, Steve, Eric, Gloria, and Phyllis. Give grace and healing to Christiane and Ruth. Be with Luann and Shelby Cooper and Yasmin. Uphold Rick Pauli. Strengthen Sharon and Kathy. Be with Larry Stabler, Carla Burham, Kathy Grubin, Chris Pacey, Brett Parrott, Don Moran, Bruce Taggy, Chris Walker, Bev Hoffman, Pastor Matthews, Diane Norris, Tawny, Scott Wilson, Pastor Drews, Teresa Kerr, Deb, Alec, Marsha, Delcy Lane, Becky Richards, Dave, Olivia Bradley, Sharon Rumble, Sherry Emberton, Sandra, Larry, Rod, Jenny, David, Shannon, Ward, Michael, Dale, Kathy, Gordon, Maureen, Pastor Neiman, Mary, Ethan, and Gail, and Jonathan. to give them all healing and strength according to your will. Support and comfort all those recovering from disasters of various sorts. And be with those who are working to bring relief and recovery in every place where they are needed. We pray that you bring peace and justice to the nations. Keep the scourge of war far off. Stay the hand of the aggressor. Comfort and guard the innocent. Grant peace to Israel and Palestine. Bring an end to the conflict between Russia and Ukraine. Heal the divisions that bring bitterness to our own nation. We especially implore your grace to bring an end to all ethnic and racial bigotry. Grant understanding, grace, and equity to all. We lift up all who have suffered violent attack this last week, praying that you grant mercy, healing, faith, and justice, O Lord. Bring us peace. Watch over Pastor Hake and his family. Bless their service. Bless the ministry of Concordia Lutheran School. Give your grace and support to all learning situations. Be with our synod and all of its officers, Matthew, our synodical president, Michael, our district president, and all synod and district officials, that they may be guided by your word to do those things that are pleasing in your sight. Grant stability, faith, and hope to all who are struggling in this economy. Bless the people of Haiti as they struggle to recover and establish a stable civil life, and grant shelter and protection to all refugees, especially those displaced by the conflict in Syria. And finally, we ask that you'd send your spirit of peace to the Sudan, Somalia, Myanmar, Venezuela, Afghanistan, Ethiopia, Kenya, Nigeria, Burkina Faso, Nagorno-Karabakh, the Middle East, especially Iraq, Egypt, Syria, and Yemen, and all places torn by war or civil strife. O Lord, in your mercy. We also ask that while our nation continues to live with peril and while many remain in harm's way, that you would watch over us and show your mercy to all who are in danger or who suffer in any way. Comfort those who mourn, heal those who are injured, give wisdom and humility to those in authority. Continue to be with Derek Foote, Alex Zook, Elizabeth Auer, Zeke Garrison, and all deployed and active duty military personnel and their families. Protect all innocent civilians everywhere. Bring the wicked to justice. Defend the righteous and lead all to repent of evil and seek your peace. We know that all things are in your hands, Father, and we ask that you would bring justice and establish fair government according to your good and perfect will. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, our heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you have safely brought us to the beginning of this day. Defend us in the same with your mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings being ordered by your governance may be righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
We join in the closing hymn. couple of things I want to draw your attention to before we let you go, hopefully to join us for a time of fellowship, and I can do Bible study if you all want to stick around for that, so that'll be your choice. But 2024 flower charts on the bulletin board across my office if you want to help out with flowers for next year. Reminder that next Sunday there will only be one 9 o'clock service. Sherry and I and the kids are off to see her mother down in Florida, so we will be out of town, and the elders will bravely carry on in my absence. 2024 offering envelopes are available on the table in the fellowship hall if you want to pick yours up. Moving on. Food and pantry needs for December are canned fruit, baked beans, mac and cheese, canned chicken. Dollar for mission envelopes are by the offering plates as you go out. And then, if you want to celebrate Christmas, come back either at 3 or at 6:30 for pre-service music or 7 for just the worship. And then tomorrow morning there will be a choral divine service at 9 a.m. And with that said, is there anything else for the good of the cause? The service has ended. Go in peace.